So with that being said, we're going to slide over under tab 5 in your binder to Mr. David Bretschneider. He's with FFA Engineering and Technical Services. And he's going to walk us through a development planning presentation.
All right. Can you all hear me without a mic or do I? I'm not used to using the mic. Appreciate it. Thanks for the opportunity to be here this evening. Tell us what we've been working on. Basically, what we saw is the site's been mostly focused at this point on D&D, and they asked us to come in and get a contract to look at a future vision. What would it take to produce a vision? What things should we be looking at to salvaging and so forth to enhance that vision? So that's what I'm going to walk you through this evening. Create a conceptual report. Keep in mind, this is a conceptual report. It's just a basic, obviously needs a lot more work in detail. But it's we produced a conceptual report, and then with that, figures to display the final site configuration and the infrastructure that would support that configuration. What we did, we came in and we reviewed site history, drawings, reports, and then we talked with representatives from FPP, DOE, SODI, and the SSAB. And then we went in and we studied each one of the different infrastructures that exist in this space. How do they function? How do they work? What makes up that each infrastructure? And then we questioned the knowledgeable people at the site, anywhere where we had questions. And then those issues that we didn't understand or didn't quite comprehend, we actually went out to the field and touched those things and asked questions with the knowledgeable people that they had to decide. What the objective was out of this effort, and again, this is the one alternative where we create a post-D&D site configuration attracted to industrial tenants. Okay, so this would be a future vision based on assuming we're going to turn it into an industrial park.
This industrial use unrelated to nuclear, including nuclear, or just in general?
General. It's just developing the site, set up the utilities and okay, what are the assumptions going into this thing that we developed in talking to people? First, retain the ACP facilities. Obviously, those needed to stay. Retain the DUF6 facilities. Those we felt needed to stay. Now, what we heard from a number of people for development of an industrial site, we kind of agree with that, is that nobody's going to want to build next to a landfill or under the top of a cliff. So our recommendation is, and we'll see that in more detail later, that we remove certain of the landfills and that we remove certain of the plumes. Now, both of those will require a lot of additional material to be, they have to be processed beyond what's in the D&D's current scope. So what we would see and what we would recommend is an on-site disposal site to put those materials, and we, as we walk through here, we'll show you what our preferred location is. Then last but not least was the preserve infrastructure, which is the value of future industrial development. Obviously, D&D is trying to do things quickly because it's cost effective, but on the other hand, are there utilities and infrastructure that needs to be saved and salvaged during the demolition? And we know from all some other areas, it's a little tricky, so it's got to be done carefully, or otherwise we'll damage things that we do want to save. So that's part of it. What did we find? Excellent access to major roadways. Obviously, on 23 on the west, you've got a full interchange and a limited access road coming directly into the site. Obviously, from the north, you've got State Route 32 and a four-lane divided highway going into the south. As Craig mentioned, excellent rail service. Northwest Southern on the along the Scioto River, and then they have a which you might call a full interchange. So meaning you can come from the south or from the north on the spur up to the site. So there's very good rail service.
Is there potential to have competing rail too?
Yeah. And I'll cover that.
What are used to?
They're used to. That's the problem. Yeah. Good sanitary water distribution system. excellent electrical supply, obviously, you know, you're center of the universe, your power, so you've got more power you can bring here. And a good distribution system, I say excellent, because there are some upgrades being planned which make that an excellent system. Good high-pressure fire water system, which is separate from sanitary water system, which is very attractive to industrial development. A wastewater collection system, existing natural gas service. And then the last one, numerous existing right-of-ways with pipelines. The reason that's attractive to us and of interest is that right now you have three pipelines bringing in raw water, they only use one of them. So the possibility exists, and actually in the future that may disappear, but the possibility exists to utilize those pipelines for other things. And what I mean is, some of them, if they're in good shape, can be utilized as they are. We can come in and put an in-situ liner in those, or we can actually drag a plastic pipe through those, use those for sleeve. They make it much cheaper and more efficient to build other lines. And you'll see when Jim presents some of his stuff, where we would propose reusing some of those existing pipelines for other services.
What did you mean they might disappear?
Oh, that'd be part of the GMD. Oh. Okay, they would be removed. They would be destroyed. Okay, what did we find for some of the negative existing conditions? Obviously, and we'll talk about that as we go on, existing landfills and groundwater plumes in the areas that we thought were prime redevelopment for industrial property. So that's the issue, because again, no one wanted to build next to a landfill or over the top of the plume. So that's a big issue. We felt that the water treatment plant is, if you've ever seen it, it's old, oversized, but more than that, it's in what we consider to be prime development property for industrial use. So we kind of like to see it go. Wastewater treatment plant's old, and you need some upgrade. And the wastewater effluent line is contaminated, and that's an issue because obviously when they get ready to remediate it, clean it up, how are we going to get rid of the wastewater during that period of time. So we've got competing interests that we need to keep the water flowing at the same time that not line needs to be cleaned out or removed. Okay, I'm going to try and educate you a little bit here in a second. As a civil engineer and developer, when you want to purchase property, one of the things you want to look for is land that's fairly level. By level, I mean, you know, not a real heavy slope. And I'm going to talk to you just a second about that. Okay, these are helpful here. On the slide.
Just slide down the wall.
And fortunately, okay. And I apologize, the site's so big it's hard to get on drawings. But it's one of the problems we've had to this thing. It's a rather large site, but if just to get your edge, you can see the railroad up here in the north. This is the north there is here. North is up this way. And what we see, the prime development land, this is what we call the property map, it's got contours on it. Each one of these lines, if you follow it around, represents an elevation. The line next to it represents an elevation 5 feet higher. So if you look at these lines kind of like steps, in areas, you look at areas like this and you see very heavy lines together. That means that that area, the steps, contours are very close together. It's a very steep area. It's really not an area where would you really want to build an industrial development, because it costs you a lot of money to cut out the material and then fill the material. An example is, if you've been to the Don Marcos substation here, you can see that area had to be heavily cut on the west side and then heavily filled to create a 2% or so grade for development. So as we look at this site, how do you use this? Okay. So I'm getting something. I'm not sure what. Okay. I'm not an expert. Okay. First of all, if you look at the site, right in through here, you see a lot of the steep contours. And basically, what you see is the northern part of the site is separated by the southern part with a little beaver creek. So that pretty much cuts the site in half, or not in half, into a north, what we call a north side, and a south side. Likewise, over here, the creek flows down through here. So again, that kind of separates this area, the east from the west over here. And in the northern area here, you can see, and on the east over in this area, you can see the contours are close together. That's not what we would consider prime development land. There's a little bit of not bad land up in this area, but right here are landfills, and that's why they look level, because they've been filled in the landfill. Likewise here, a level area, but unfortunately that's a live sludge pond. So we don't consider the area above and to the east of Little Beaver Creek to be of much interest for industrial development. Likewise, the utilities on the site we found to mostly be involved in this area. So we, in our report, we refer to this area as the plateau because it's really fairly flat. In fact, it's very flat. And it's actually a problem for future development. It's almost too flat. And actually, because what's happened is the site over the years has developed all the storm sewers in piping. So the site's virtually level in the area where it's been developed up in here. And all the drainage is taken away by piping. Now, one of the things we would recommend for the industrial development is that we get rid of all the piping and go to an open channel system, open drainage, which would be cheaper. So basically, again, with the creek here, this area isn't too interesting, too much interest. This is the area that we're mostly interested in. Based on that same logic and analysis, we talked about with all the plumes and sanitary landfills, or the landfills that we like to build, we would propose an on-site disposal facility. And we would see that the disposal facility ought to be built up here on the north side, which is an area that we are not interested in industrial development. But I think the site, one of the primaries, of course, one of the sites everyone has here, we like to say, don't build it there. Build it up here in the north area, up here where it's out of the way of the land that we consider a prime value for industrial property. Okay, what do we see as a possible landscape? This is our pie in the sky, if you will, but it's what we feel would be an ideal to create an industrial park. First of all, what I didn't show you on the last slide, right in this area right here, right along here, on the west side of the X330 building and the X326 or X328, 2.8. There's underground tunnels virtually that people can walk through. Virtually about eight and a half, 9 feet tall, and at least 12 or so feet wide. We would see that as the natural divide between what would be left is the DOE property, and what would be ideal for the industrial property. So what we would propose, or what we're showing here, is we would propose to take those tunnels and instead of backfilling them when you excavate or tear them out, actually create a drainage canal, making an open drainage system. And you can see that we would drain this one this way and this one this way. So we'd like to see an open drain. Well, the major road, of course, the primary road over here to get to the site is the principal access road, which comes in from 23, has a full interchange over on 23. In the development industrial park, that interchange to us is obviously a very valuable asset. The problem is, when you come into the site, right in this area, right where the red line starts there, that road turns and comes into the DOE area. So the main road, the vert comes right into the DOE area. What we'd like to do, and it's also in the security area, obviously right now security is out here and can't use that. We'd like to see this road opened up to the public and extend a straight line out to the center of the site where we can reach the public portion of the site. As a matter of fact, we'd like to see it extended all the way across the site And actually even rebuilt the east access road. The east access road has, if you look at it, as kind of a failed base and it needs work. What we'd like to propose is just straighten this out very nicely and just build a new east access road, if ideal. Again, you said, I have no proposals. So you'd have access from east to west, very clear access. Likewise, coming in from the north, we have north access road, which currently turns and goes underneath the railroad. It backs down to a two-way road and goes underneath the railroad trestle, which we feel like by the end of D&D, it's already looks pretty old. By the time D&D is completed, we feel like it's kind of reached its useful life. So what we'd like to see, well, we're going to leave that up. Oops. Sorry. very sorry. First of all, this, got to be careful which button. From the site right currently is existing Pike Avenue. And it runs down the middle of the site on the east side of two of the large, 330 and 326. The reason that road is of interest to us is it's the heart of industrial development. That is what you might say to be the heart of industrial development. What you have is already a road. We could salvage a lot of it. But it also has all the utilities along. It's really a utility corridor. It's the main utility corridor that we would see that we could leave behind rather than tear down as planned to form this. It would be the feed for this industrial corridor. Now, obviously, what we're proposing is a symbiotic relationship where even though there's only one line here, would continue, like, for example, I'll talk about it in a minute. Each utility would be shared utilities. There would be, while there would be a main line down through these areas, and we would like to say that line would still continue to be tied into the DOE. Because without any water systems and stuff, you want loop systems, so if you have a failure, valves, pipeline or stuff, you still can reach and maintain the service. So to us, this road, and its utilities is the heart of what we think would be an industrial development. Now, knowing that's the heart of the development, we come up here to the North Access Road. Like I said, it comes in, you know, it goes underneath the railroad, and then it comes into the site in this area. And what we would like to see is once we make this, or agree that this is our main artery, so to speak, is to actually extend that up to the North Access Road, so the North Access Road would be realigned and come right into the center of the DOE industrial complex divide. So the DOE traffic come in and go this way to the DOE and the public traffic can go to the industrial site. What we would propose then is the North Access Road, and this is a case where, if not, you know, with the on-site disposal cell, they need a haul road to get the material up to the cell. So we would propose using that North Access Road as a hallway, as a haul road, which I'm sure will be destroyed because of the heavy equipment. So it would have to be replaced when we're done anyway. So we would propose to just cut that off and from really, where it doesn't show on here, I apologize, but the creeks in this way, really from the south side of the creek on down, get rid of it because we feel like this area here is prime where the water treatment plant and where the North Access Road currently cuts through is prime industrial development land. We'd like to steal that land as part of the industrial park. Likewise, for drainage, the site really drains more south, east, and west. And what we see is a stormwater retention basin at each one of the entrance points to the site. We say retention base because we like the idea of a nice lake when you come in, it's kind of a positive sign. But also in industrial development, we have to provide stormwater runoff control. So it's a retention basin because when it rains, the water will be retained and drain out slowly so it doesn't cause damage to downstream existing facilities. So we would propose four retention basins. Basically at each one of the entrances into the site from the south. And I'm sorry, I didn't mention too, we would like to see the road Once it comes through, it extends directly into the south. So you really are coming directly into this main artery, if you would. Let's see. Just like right on the other one, those are the same. Like I said, one of the things we'll also do, you'll see that in the grading plan later on, is we're proposing wherever water goes now, stormwater runoff goes, if we're going to future, we want to maintain existing drainage data. So we don't go shift the water to other properties in other directions. So all these basins, the grading plan you'll see later is proposed, laid out to maintain the existing drainage of the facility. Okay, likewise, railroad. Right now, like we mentioned, we have from the northwest, we have a major spur from the North Fork and Southern Railroad. Unfortunately, we used to have a spur this way, which was the B&O Railroad, Chessie system, I keep changing their name at different times. But unfortunately, that's been taken out. That's no longer exists. So we are totally dependent on Russell. Trestle's still there. I'm sorry, the one right here is. I don't know what was beyond that. I've never researched. But essentially then, what we have is the rail traffic now has come through the site, and automatically it turns this way, and then it has to be brought back into the site. And I haven't got the existing tracks on here, but right now it comes in and comes back down this way.
Did you assess what it would take to reconfigure or rebook up and have actually to be around?
Oh, no, we didn't look at that. Yeah, I doubt if you're going to get that put back in. It's hard to build railroads anymore. I assume they probably, I haven't researched it again, but they probably sold off water anyway or probably developing. I don't know that for sure, but usually what happens is this area goes pretty quick, or at least in some areas, I don't know. What we'd like to propose is that the trackies come in and turn it and direct it parallel with this new north access road and bring it directly into the site. And we'd like to keep a trunk line here on the public side of the property. Okay, so the train stays on the public side of the property, the rail system. You can see, it's a little hard to see there, I apologize, but we're looking at, in this area here, we think we can get trackage next to the 310 building. And down in this area, then we intercept the trackage that already exist down in this area for the XT 847 building. So essentially, we'd like to bring a new trunk line down through here that skirts right along the edge of the swale we were talking about, so that this railroad track combined with the swale is maybe 100 feet high or wide with the ditch. Kind of forms a physical barrier between the DOE and the public portion of the property. So we kind of got a physical divide. We think that would be a nice asset. Likewise, then we would see that the rail spurs remove the rails, existing rails over to this side, and let the DOE come down off the public spur or main line here, and take their spurs off so they can maintain security. Okay, because that will be an issue, obviously, in the future. And obviously, we want to pull all the security back to this, basically, this divide here, with DOE occupying, for now, this part of the western part of the site and the southern part of the site over to the new access road. Likewise, up top here, once we bring the main railroad track in through this way, we see that this existing trackage would only become a railroad spur over to the lumber company that exists up in this area. So we feel like the traffic at that point would be very limited, so we would propose this would be an act-grade crossing here, because of the limited volume of rail traffic that would be going east, since we're now bringing the flow of traffic into the site. Okay, likewise, we would propose, since the on-site disposal cell is over here, some of the other landfills are over here, and like I said, this area above Little Beaver Creek really is not that much interest in industrial development without it's very extensive. But, is taking the existing fog road, which is now used to bypass obviously the security. Once we move the security over to this area here, then we would like to see fog road basically. It's kind of a windy road, doesn't have good berms on the edges, and the bridge is in deteriorating condition. We'd like to just scrap it. We would just make these dead end roads and make this just for access for maintenance of the DOE facilities. So we're trying to pull the public over here away from the disposal cell, away from the lime sludge fill pond, away from the closed landfill over that area. Likewise, we were asked by Steve Shepard, and if there's any buildings we would consider that would be of value to use for the future. We really, as you'll see in later slides, we really don't see salvage in anything in this area. As a matter of fact, right now the National Guard, it's hard to tell where they are, during here, we would propose moving the National Guard up in this area. You can see right there, proposed to get them out of the way of industrial development, open this whole area up for the industrial development. As far as buildings, say, there's five buildings we're interested in that were questionable, whether they were on the D list, the D&D list or not. And I think it kind of bounces back and forth. But these five buildings down here, the XT Angel 1 office building, the 847 warehouse, the administration building, and the data processing building of the fire station. I think that the latest is that the ACP is going to want to use those buildings. But I would say that we need to keep an eye on those because we feel like those buildings are valuable for possible future public use if the DOE doesn't decide to keep them for themselves. Any of the rest of the buildings, we didn't see anything really worthwhile salvaging. And again, the nice thing about these buildings also is they are not tied to the steam system, which is we would see going away. So they're heated by gas, so that makes it a little bit better. So again, I think the latest is that DOE will probably keep those buildings, but I would say we want to keep, as a public, you should keep your eye on, make sure that nobody just, takes them. Next slide, please. Okay, well, I just run you through a typical utility. This is to give you a flavor of what we were looking at when we talked about the infrastructure. Next slide. Okay, again, the site simplified. Here's our new rail line. Here's these swales. Okay, what we see is there's an existing this is proposed sanitary. We're just going to pick one of the utilities that picked the sanitary ward. Just give you an idea of what we're looking at. Right now, there's you can see the sanitary water distribution system that will remain on the western part of the boundary. That will remain unchanged. We don't see any changes in that. But in order to open this up, we really need to regrade this whole area to set it up. But there's a main line. Pipeline that comes down and I think ties it around about here. We would like to see that pipeline maintained and actually extend down a completely looped system so that the whole system has a number of loops and so forth. Again, in case of a failure, any part of it could be back then. And that's where, again, we see the symbiotic relationship between DOE and the public because your line, the line we stay on the public side, would become a loop system for their system in case they have any pipe failures and so forth. So the unfortunate part is if we're going to remove these plumes, we're probably going to have to take up those sections of the pipeline to dig out that material. So they would have to be replaced, which adds a little bit of volume. Likewise, you can see on this one, there is a line down in this area where we would propose a new east-west road. So we were trying to salvage that too, because eventually we'd like to see that extended and tied in down here so we could do some industrial development over here too. So that's just a typical, all the utilities, fire, water, similar. Electrical, again, a lot of the utilities are already located along what I see this as being the heart of an industrial development. We want to maintain that corridor because of all the utilities that are in that corridor. Okay, next slide. Okay, a possible development plot. What do we think this thing would look like for industrial development? Okay, this is kind of the way we see the plot plan laid out. What we see is initially, we could see about 683 acres of industrial development that would be come out of this industrial park. And actually, once the DUF six cylinders are processed, which is obviously a part of this D&D, we could see where this area could also become, and another almost 100 acres to industrial development. And actually, that is pretty flat land. That's prime land up there too. But again, you can see where we would have the new north-south road here, the new east-west road here. We would see the spacing between the railroad track and the new north-south road, which is existing High Street, is large enough that we can swing the railroad and make turns out. So for example, this is what we initial turn in. We could bring a rail spur right into here, which would break off into these properties. Mostly this large property. This one we're also showing the spur we propose it to be north, so you can do the same thing and turn south wherever it would be convenient. So again, this would be the part that we feel like D&D could possibly put into their D&D scope of work to reestablish that. Any of these other spurs would have to be future development by whoever develops the property. This one, you can see the lots. We did dig a lot. These are drainage swales in green. We proposed a certain amount of drainage swales, and you can't read it, but each parcel of property is on there so that you can see what size of properties would be available to development. Next slide. Likewise, just in case you thought you could pull in some larger industrial developments, there is a possibility of taking the whole northern part, removing the old perimeter road, which is not really necessary, and making that a large parcel. The other opportunity for a large parcel is down here. You also see that we propose this part over here to be used for industrial development. Now, the disadvantage of this property, and we see this will be later on if you get the rest of this developed. This property over here, when we went back on the contour map, is a more rugged property. Still not real steep, but it's steep enough that you'll have to terrace it. So the property, developments would be off level and an embankment behind it. So it's not prime land, but because it's tied in with this, we think it is potential, maybe more commercial type development in the future. Likewise, you'll see here, when we bring this north-south road in, we're proposing to cut off this section of the perimeter road, and basically that's to give this area open range for the railroad, so it doesn't interfere so much. Doesn't have so many road crossings. And then number two, that pretty much cuts the DOE part of the site off from the public portion of the site. Again, the security is going to have to be maintained, so security is an issue. We'll see. Likewise, you'll see here that we are proposing to remove the existing water treatment plant. We're also proposing to, right now this road comes in and swings in this way, and we'll get to that in a second, but we're proposing a rearrangement on that part of the property. If we could shift the next one. Okay, suggested remediation to go with this industrial plant. Okay, this is maybe a bad assumption, but on this site, I assume you're somewhat familiar with the landfills and the plumes. We have landfills up here, landfills here. Landfill here, we have the active lime sludge pond, which is really the same as what this is here. This one's still active. You have plumes in the purple, here, 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 and here, and then we have landfills in the red here. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, and I apologize, I couldn't kind of get these blend of the drawings. So figuratively, here's what you just saw on the last slide with our overlay of what we would see development. What we would see is to get this north access road in, we would have to remove this landfill, or at least part of it, to get that roadway in here. Likewise, then when we get into the site, we see these three landfills should be removed and pulled out of here to build the industrial site. And we see this plume, these two plumes, and this plume needing to be removed, needing to be dug up and removed. And of course, a lot of that material goes into the cell, which we'll talk about how we replace that on the next slide. This area over here remains under DOE control. So, and this is such a huge plume down here, we don't see that it's economical to remove that plume. But that's something somebody else is going to decide. But they didn't feel like that interfered with the industrial park. That is on DOE property, on what we would leave as DOE property. Likewise, these landfills with River Bank, because they're on the DOE property. Likewise, these landfills were up here. Again, this is where the Ohio National Guard will be relocated. So it's not on the public portion. The other landfills would remain for the ground site disposal, so we see up in this area here. Next slide. Okay, what is the possible grading plan look like? Again, this is conceptual, it's very basic, but it's at least a logical plan of how we develop. Again, you see pretty much what we said, north-south road, with all the utilities in here, and grading to maintain those utilities best we can. The new east-west road, the new drainage basins, the drainage swales, the four stormwater retention basins. Because we're proposing cutting off the main access to DOE here, we would see this section of the road wide to four lanes because we want to move the security here that's on the main east-west road, open that to the public and bring it into the site down in this area. So they would need more access with the new security here for this part of the property. But basically what you have on here, we didn't do any grading in this area because, again, it's not disturbed now. They have to be disturbed if you develop that area. But in this area here, you can see extensive grading. And what it would amount to is you're going to be pulling out a lot of dirt from these plumes that literally excavate these plumes. So what we're proposing, and what we'd like to see, where the existing water treatment plant is, if you're familiar, it sits up on a pretty good knob, okay, probably 25 feet above the perimeter of next to it. We'd like to take that knob, that whole knob, we want to get rid of the water treatment plant, cut that whole knob out of there and use that to backfill this area where the plumes are moved, and then to regrade this area. And what we've shown on here is all the grading at 2%. This is really a rough grading plan because we don't want standing water, we want a nice clean, and what we see is a 2% slope, a quarter inch per foot. You'll see a lot of concrete driveways, things like that, with a cost of a quarter inch per foot. That really is the minimum slope you need to keep the water off of, otherwise we should have water sitting everywhere. So everything here we're showing grading at 2%. Likewise, what we're showing here, if you're familiar with it now, the existing east perimeter road comes in and goes around toward the 100 building. And here we would propose carving out that whole knob in that area. We're talking about a couple million cubic yards of dirt. And you would need that to develop and fill in the pond down here and regrade this section to good grades for industrial development. I don't know, let's see. But again, it's got the rails, everything that we talked about in the previous slides. I'm sorry, yeah, okay. Next slide, please. So, what we also found is with the water supply and wastewater, two of our most significant recommendations involve the water supply treatment and wastewater treatment and discharge. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Jim and let Jim talk through that.
Question before you do that.
Sure.
On the industrial side, How many plumes, there's only one plume, excuse me, only one, the landfill is lined. How many of the landfill are you leaving? You're leaving just one online, is that what I saw, or?
We're just removing those that are emptying out.
The industrial side?
On the industrial side. Yeah, just
all of them?
Down, one's down the south of the line, 749, and seven, and the PRD wildland are not lined.
So there was two of them that would have been left.
Three of them.
Let's put it this way. Those were removed in our plan.
Yes.
We don't need those removed to develop the plan. Now, I'm not sure the rest of the discussions with EPA, saying that they wouldn't be removed anyway. In other words, I'm not saying they stay because we don't need them. I'm saying we don't need them for this plan.
What's your proposal? Yes, thanks.
Thanks, Dave. I promise I'll be very brief. Dave, I think it's pretty well covered, just about everything that we've done. And I would like to comment, I think our conceptual future vision dovetails almost identically to what Greg was starting out with initially, and that's, you know, communication with everybody, giving, throwing out ideas, et cetera. And as the slide says, two of the most significant things are water supply and wastewater treatment. Give me the next slide, please. Now the next one.
Gee, I'm not the only one, okay.
This particular figure shows the overall site again. I'm going to talk it and give you the flavor and discussion on what our, again, future vision and concept is for the proposed off-site infrastructure. As Dave pointed out before us, internally to the plateau area, which is our main area of concentration for the development, is the water supply and wastewater treatment. I'm going to speak to the water supply first. In our initial investigations, we've found, and that's one of the reasons we're recommending that the site get out of the water business, if you will, because we need it for the development. We need the water treatment plant goals we discussed. We need material for backfill, et cetera. So the water treatment plant is generally right in that area there. But our initial investigations have found, well, gee, it all hinges really around the timing of D&D as to when this might happen. And we don't really have a feel for that right now, at least I don't. I don't know if anyone else does either. But at the proper point in time, when a water treatment plant goes out of business, at that point in time, we feel that it's necessary to become, again, part of the region and become part of a existing water utility. And by virtue of doing that, there is a way or method of feeding a water line from 32 into the north side and tying into the loop that exists. And right now, there also exists a line right now on US 23 that serves the OVEC facility. That could be very easily extended in and tied in to the existing lines that already serve the facility. There again, being a good engineering practice, that performs not only an internal loop to the area, but an outside loop so that you have a double-ended system, just like you do an electrical distribution system.
So what the capacity would be?
I'm sorry. No, that's one of the details that are unknown. We don't know what the capacity needs to be. In my mind, it really depends on the D&D effort, how much water needs to be supplied at any point in time.
What about available capacity?
Right now, I think from the initial, again, I emphasize initial investigation, is 20 million gallons a day is what's capacity. Which may necessitate, depending on development, if you will, and the water users, expanding localized plants. Okay? That to my mind, way of thinking is
not. I don't think we'll be using 20 million, but.
No, it's not that high.
A couple less than that. Right? Yeah. But I'm talking about from the existing external or public water supplies. What's their capacity capability through the existing pipes on the north and the
we don't know that's
we think the pipes are large enough to bring, again, the demand is high right now because there's a number of D&D demands at the site.
Your water usage on the site is going to significantly go down as the D&D progresses. Okay. When all the D&D, the only thing we'll be left are maybe the users in the existing facility over in this area with all this D&D. So what that number is, I don't know at the moment. But it's certainly, you know, the process by comparison is much, much smaller than the rest. Because these are, you know, what's there now and scheduled for DD are tremendous water usage. for cooling and second.
But you've also looked at existing, I think what Dan was asking, this is done in the back, water, supply of water on the kind of south and west side of the facility, like when you talk to higher water, which supplies all around, and also, and you look at some of their existing capacity, their existing lines.
Initially, the potential was there, but again, I think you have to be reserved to indicate, or somewhere along the line, the determination has to be, well, how much water do you need and when? And are those existing lines capable of supplying? That's a very good question. I don't know the answer to that yet.
We feel like the lines are large enough to supply the initial DOE host usage. Now, the concern then would be, okay, as the industrial park develops, can you bring in more water?
Yeah, and along that line, one of the things that we looked at, again, initially, with the initial tie into the north and to the west, and as Dave mentioned before, there's an existing 48-inch raw water line that now feeds an existing water plant. Okay, 48-inch raw water line. Okay, that's the water. Lots of water there. Of course, that's a 40 million gallon a day plant initially. But as Dave indicated before, again, I'm thinking out in the future, depending on the water need, that 48-inch raw water line and its easement, et cetera, could be used as a conduit for a new water line from pipe water through a well system. They expanded their facilities in DP, but that's an easement that's already there, could be used. It doesn't have to be torn out as part of D&D. So again, in my mind, that's pretty far out. Is it such an unknown? When would you need that? I don't know. I don't know that anybody does. It depends on how quickly this area develops.
And what's developed?
Big pardon?
And what's developed?
And what's exact? We don't know. Again, keep in mind, this is a conceptual vision on our part. But it's certainly, in my mind, the potential is certainly there. Just to reiterate, initially you have a connection at the north and the west to tie in the site and make a complete loop system, externally and internally. Along that same line, the existing wastewater treatment plant, even though it may be outdated, I think it does have some improvements, is generally located right there. And in our mind, as D&D progresses, the wastewater treatment capacity will diminish, and we're feeling that right now the wastewater treatment plant from the Sarangota capacity is adequate. So our thoughts and recommendation is though, even though that's so, that initially and then for the future development of this area, that we start thinking about a regional approach to tie in with a public utility for this entire region. And I mentioned, I think a dialogue needs to be started to make that happen. And our, again, vision and concept is that at some point in time, that a regional approach, we anticipate the possibility of a regional system off-site down above the floodplain area along US 23. And as we mentioned before, the existing outfall line is contaminated so that it definitely is going to have to be taken out as far as D&D. Well, it's kind of coincidentally along that line, there is an existing well field with a 30-inch diameter raw water feed line coming into the site now. And our thought is, well, okay, let's plan on possibly using that as an effluent line because it exists, it's 30-inch, and the right-of-way is there, et cetera. So when you take out the existing contaminated outfall line, we already have a ready-made one to utilize to come down to the regional plant and then spawn out to the Scioto River. And all these details of that have to be worked out. That, in our mind, is certainly a vision of the potential of what can happen. Try the next slide. All right, now, okay, our end result then, and this is some reiteration of what Dave said. The end result is we're going to have approximately 720 acres for industrial development, for you guys to sell, okay? And an additional 100 acres up with the DUF 6 is, as soon as that all gets processed out, that'll be another 100 acres available for future land use. And the end result, again, just to reiterate what we have here, and from an industrial utility and an industrial development, these are ideal utilities to have. We have a brand new and improved roadway access, both north, south, east, west, quarters, major electric supply, water, wastewater,
water, natural gas, potential rail, real life stormwater runoff, open channel flow, if you will, aesthetically. Developments can be made all along perimeter road, either large developments and or support facilities. You can envision what most industrial parks I see that have large industry have all kinds of support facilities around them. That's their bread and butter. That same thing can happen here. And the end result, in our mind, is this could be one of the creation of one of the largest industrial parks in the state of Ohio. And that's no joke.
Thank you.
Hey, Donnie, you mind hitting the lights for us? Are there any questions for either David or Jim from the board? Yes, Gene, we'll start with you.
I commend you gentlemen for such a broad, extensive presentation tonight. So that certainly is interesting, the findings and recommendations that they have. I would just focus on one part of the presentation, and that focus that centers on the waste cell, the waste site that's out there now. You mentioned the shoe that's out there and the plumes. As a board member, I've sat here several times with y'all, and the last meeting we had the public comments in regards to this subject.
Stormwater and open channel flow, if you will, is
the idea of the development of the waste cell being isolated there up on the hill, rather than as Mr. Reitzner said, to be more attractive than having, that no one would be attracted to having those down on, you know, to build on top of them, which I think we'd all agree with that. But why not? The other side is that, and some people feel that why not take all of the waste out and ship it out? Well, the two reasons, probably money or cost and time. I find it hard to see where potential industry would find it attractive to have a waste out there. And correct me if I'm wrong, but I noticed that the divided there, there's one I have the public side and the DOE part. The DOE part is going to leave some of those there and but have it cleared on the public side for the future industry. I've listened to the majority of people the other night that we listened to, even the employees, I'll call it the plant, support removal of the waste rather than having the waste cell. The people in the community support that. So I guess, are we saying that, excuse me, based on the information we're getting, the presentation we hear leads us to be that people are optimistic about this waste sale that's going to happen. Is it cost prohibitive that this, to consider all waste removal, that can't happen? Or I was told that the time figure was like 4 years longer. So if you can answer those questions, basically, the waste cell versus removal of the waste.
Okay.
Because that, I think our survey OU did was of course, been discussed tonight about, Pike County leads the state in unemployment, and people are wanting jobs, they're hurting for jobs, there's no question about that. But not just any jobs. I mean, I just am wondering if those who are hopeful that the waste should be removed, are we looking at a dead horse? I mean, so to speak, that's an impossibility because of the time and cost.
Thank you, Mike Professor.
You gonna say something?
I guess, Dennis, I don't know if you want to say something, but, you know, what, Dennis, what we've been contracted now to do, and we're working on it now, is if all of it's shipped off-site, the alternative. And I can tell you right now, the alternative is, if it's going, if all the money's going to be spent to shipping, which is tremendous amount of additional cost, that these landfills that we were showing up here will not be removed. The plumes will continue to be pump and treat. That's what we're recommending for the non-on-site disposal. So you're really, I think it's really, from our perspective, and I don't know if you or somebody else wants to, it's really, the cell is the only cost-effective way to get rid of the plumes and the existing landfills that really are acceptable where they're at as far as legality or regulatorily. So we're really kind of putting the cell to trade off to clear out the area for industrial development versus if it's going to be shipped. A lot of these things, matter of fact, I can tell you it's not going to look anything like this from what we've already sketched up. It's going to be not really set up for prime development of an industrial facility. It'll be a hodgepodge. And I don't know that anyone would want to come in and do that. So I think from our perspective, you're kind of trading one for the other. And that's probably a decision that has to be made. Dennis, do you want to add anything to that?
I'd like to just, again, when I talked earlier, I was talking about a vision, and that's a vision from afar. Seeing things on paper, as a former planner at OVRDC, that's the easy part. You have to always make assumptions, and this is long term. And when I was doing my presentation, as we developed that, what I thought was, how do we talk about how these decisions are interrelated, and how can we show one of the potential bridges to the future? It's clear that we heard jobs and job creation are critical in this area. We all know that. And so when you go and look at State of Ohio's Development Department and what they have available for industrial development, if you consider, now they've eliminated the DOE, like DF6 and ACP from their planning, but if you look at that perimeter road, that's about 1,200 to 1,300 acres of industrial land. You have two existing tenants. If you look at that in total, you're talking about, when you go to the State of Ohio's website, it would be the third largest industrial park that I saw listed about 3 weeks ago. So it would be large scale. And what we're trying to demonstrate was that these decisions on their own are difficult, but they're related. I'm not saying the thing that anything is dead at this point, but what they were doing was putting together a vision and how they thought was a logical way that you would go forward to get to a point where we could have a larger scale development. It's also, as a planner, like I said, it's easy to put it on paper. Val brought me back to reality. He said I didn't want to minimize the effort. I watched, you know, like Maria, she's going to be at the table as these types of decisions. The Ohio EPA is going to be critical as we go forward with this. But for a planning document, looking at 20 years into the future, whatever the number of years are, you have to make assumptions. And what they saw and what they recommended was what they saw as the most logical way that we can go forward with a large-scale industrial development. I'm not saying that's the only one, but that's the scenario that they looked at, and that was their recommendation. That doesn't mean that that's what we would follow. Certainly not what we've got written down in our plans. What we're trying to do is to convey that we need to come together on a large vision. And how we get there, that's the decisions that you're making right now. But we really need to look at where we're going in the future, the redevelopment, where we are now, and agree to that destination so that we can start down the road making these decisions. They're not easy. We know that. It's difficult. But, you know. Did that help, Chief?
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. So great. Just a little bit more on your question, Chief. I think without a doubt, nobody wants anything left. That's just the nobody wants anything left. Some of this, was incorporating, a lot of the discussion that's been going on here for a couple of years. And it was, you know, the plumes, I think you heard it, in subcommittee and stuff, with landfills, I'm sorry, a lot of those are already closed on site. And actually, they've done regulatory closure. And we have maintenance activities, we still carry on with those things, and there's reevaluation periods and stuff like that, but right now, those are, I mean, officially closed. That's not saying you can't, somebody can't, you know, go and say, hey, no, we want those dug up too. But that's a big deal, and it will take some time. Plume-wise, you know, traditional method to treat plumes is pump and treat. And again, that takes a long time to do. And you do that now, you know, mention that pretty much every meeting, and we've done this much, you know, TC removal from the groundwater. I think, you know, what they're looking at is if you did something on site where you had to, you know, consolidate, and just like, why do your garage, you know, move everything to the corner so you can park your car in there, at least that's what I did last weekend. Instead of putting clean soil, which you have to have, you know, as part of the waste, you know, you might make the case that instead of clean soil, why don't you use contaminated soil? If that would make sense, then you go, okay, you know what, why don't I go dig the plumes up? If I took the route with no on-site sale, then okay, dig the plumes up, then it's a cost to dig them up and ship them and pay for disposal off-site. So that again increases the cost. So it's, and all that was just a, you know, what they did was, hey, you know, just conceptually, what would be, you know, the sweet spot of the site for reindustrialization? I think everybody's heard about it, you're clear at this point. And they overlaid that on the existing site, you know, I guess impediments, maybe the better word to that, reindustrialization. So that's all that was. That cast and concrete, you know, I think they just went out and said, hey, you're king for the day, give them what you got, you know, put something on a piece of paper. I think that's what they just presented there. So, you know, nothing's cast in concrete. You know, these are just options, kind of taking this whole process maybe a step further for consideration. And so that's probably how I describe it.
All right, we'll do Dan and come back to Val. Dan?
I think they pretty much answered the scope of their subcontracting group, and they were put together to basically come up with some scenario or a scenario. And that was their purpose. I figured we recommend that, in essence, they were just coming up with a snapshot, and it's only one of any or endless number. So, but I didn't understand, but I wasn't fully aware of that until they kind of concluded.
Okay. Beth, I guess my question would be this, and the further discussion which we need to have in much more detail. Is your understanding of what you presented tonight would somehow fall within the scope of DOE, within EM, in their mission? Are you two guys telling us that? You think that what was presented is, could be a reality?
We're at the bottom of the totem pole in the conversation. But, you know, I think you could make the case, again, if you had some ability to say, hey, you know, I need contaminated, I'd rather use contaminated soil than clean soil, for example. I think you might be able to make the case that, you know, dig up the plume as your source of contaminated soil.
Yeah.
You kind of quick remedy to part of the environmental problem that we have at the site.
Well, I guess my thinking was going a little deeper than that, along the lines of conversion of those tunnels and the roads in, the rail spur, all the detail that you presented, highly technical detail, even if it's just presented the way it was tonight. So I guess what we need to make up our mind is we struggle with these decisions, get input from the public, from everyone. We spent too much time in Southern Ohio with maybes and could bes and over the years. And so whatever we do, at least in my way of thinking, we want to make sure that there's reality and practicality tied to it, or we're wasting our time. I don't want to waste anybody's time. This is too important, and there's just too many decisions that need to be made.
the cell itself is, in my opinion, he has not decided what goes in that cell. If there is a cell, it's not been decided. So is Ohio EPA from a regulatory standpoint going to sign off on what you proposed tonight? There's a lot of questions that still need to be addressed and asked and looked at. But I think that we don't understand that this is indeed a reality. It could be a reality that we're wasting our time. I won't do that. So that's where I'm comfortable with that.
Well, we tried to propose this. I mean, we saw a number of places where we thought we could save on the DOE, on the DED. You know, like the tunnels. You know, yeah. The tunnels is a swale, so we don't have to spend all the money for backfill.
Sure.
You reutilizing two of the existing pipelines in the right of way, so we don't have to tear those out.
Right.
You know, we feel like there has to be money in the D&D for a new water treatment plant or whatever. We'd rather propose tying in with public, but a certain amount of money would have to go to support them. Because they're not going to, they may have enough capacity and whatever for the initial DOE development, but then if you start selling off industrial properties, we probably have to bring that new line in that we talked about. But then again, we'd like to save that line rather than D&D it. Save that cost of D&D, turn that line over to the public utility that they can just thread a new line through there. So we tried to look at things that would save on the cost, but then certainly, if we're going to remove landfills that are regulatorily closed, it's hard to justify shipping those 2,000 miles away when they're already acceptable the way they are. And that's where we thought, again, our recommendation would be the on-site disposal, because it's not nearly as expensive as it will be to ship all that kind of, because it's like digging up the plumes. I mean, we're talking about some significant quantities here, you know, if we're going to dig them up. And now, obviously, you weigh against pumping, treating, I don't know, you know, offhand, we're pumping and treating for another 50 years.
Right.
That is expensive to that too. Yeah, so we try to look at things that we could save that money on D&D, but at the same time, there's no question some of those road extensions, relocating some of the railroads. Again, we tried to salvage what we could. We tried to lay things out like Pike Street. That's the main corridor. The utilities are right now scheduled to come out. We're saying, no, save those, you know, save them. So we're saving maybe some things. On the other hand, there's no question that during the need to salvage those and not damage them accidentally is going to be a cost too. So.
Right.
But we try to get pluses and minuses and try and certainly I think obvious to everybody, it's going to cost more than what's in the strictly D&D budget.
Well, my point is we have no money under the DOE, so we need to find out the money that's being spent here. We need to find out if it is accessible for the type of things we talked about tonight, because it'll make a big decision in the future as we get input from the public and we find out what people really want to do. So it's extremely important in the recommendations that we make in the future that we truly hear and understand that this is indeed, in general, what the public would like to do when we propose those things. And we know that these things are attainable, or we're going to be 10, 15 years down the road, and we're not going to be getting where we're going to get. So
I would say with the plan we proposed tonight that the cell almost has to go with that plan.
Yeah,
because, I mean, there's no question that we're adding cost to the project, and the hope would be this, where can we save cost?
Yeah.
I think the two have to go hand in hand with this proposal. Like I said, we're looking at the non-on-site disposal system now, and I can tell you it's not going to be a good industrial site. There'll be land, but it's not going to be an industrial site.
Yeah.
It's you know.
Thank you. Okay, we've got Dan, Shirley, did you still have anything? And Dick. Before we go on, let me see if we get some clarification from Joel and Greg. We had the two presentations tonight. From a board perspective, are they data points that you just filed us with information, or are they things that you want them to weigh in, comment-wise, and provide
that's
talks about to you guys on? Is there?
Very good.
Well, again, I mean, all we're trying to do is collect, you know, the conversations that have been going on for quite some time. And as part of any project, you know, if you're going to build a house or just imagine anything. You have to know what finish looks like. And so, so what we're trying to do is part of, you know, we got these decisions out there. Now's the time to come up with what finish looks like. And as a part of that way, you can make things complementary to each other. and kind of what Greg pitched up during the presentation. I'm not saying it has to be that. That's just one idea of, something. And, pick the thing up there and throw darts at it, comment on it, water it up there, ball the other way. It's an attempt to start fitting stuff out there kind of along the lines that at least what we think we've heard and to pass something on.
Okay, so be a good jumping off point to put together your thoughts, what you've seen, and kind of use this as a starting point to provide some hard information back to the department. We like this part. Gene obviously had some concerns with some of the issues. You could voice those opinions as a group and kind of start helping flush this out. So, Dan.
Whether it be that particular or any alteration or any element of that presentation, how do you enforce or assure occurrence? Meaning, some things make sense, we'll leave this, we'll not do this, or we have to put a road in, we'll put it here. Let's assume nothing else on the disposal cell or landfills, just take that out for a moment. How do you assure that happens? So, if, for example, if the discussion is, well, we think this, and this makes sense, how do you assure that occurs with any reliability and assurance? Or if it was the entire element, how do you ensure that? Do you work with a surety bond and coverage with a third party that guarantees the payment of those activities to occur on a certain day and time, so that whatever that end vision is, it actually does occur as opposed to, never occur? How does that happen? And that's, I don't think anyone has an answer for that, but other than I do think the surety bond would work as an option, but it certainly would be a unique way of doing something. Just something to think about, because I think that's a reservation that no matter what the plan is, whether it's that vision or another vision or anything in between, you got to have one, and then you got to get there. And then how do you assure that you get there, and then you have whatever's left or whatever desire at least is accomplished? And I think that's a challenge. Not a criticism. Normally I'm sarcastic, but I think that's a realistic thing.
Your recommendation as a board also, we're not asking you, does the water line make sense here, or do you move it over 10 feet? Well, what I thought we had in mind, at least when we put together what I wanted to present tonight, was the concept. To have an industrial park, well, you got to have water, you got to have roads. How can we accomplish that? Make some assumptions, understanding that when you develop a piece of property, you're just putting lines on the map. You're not digging anything yet. And I think that if a recommendation were to come forward and spell out what you had as a vision, then you have to, maybe you have to put in there, with the required infrastructure. Maybe we can't accept it. I don't know what the answer is to that, but I understand exactly what you're saying. But I'm thinking that the recommendation process is where you come together on a vision, and not specifically a 10-inch line versus a 12-inch line on the location, but it's the concept of an industrial park, it's the concept of required infrastructure to have a first-class industrial park, maximize the reuse potential. And I think just that, in my mind, to justify the expense of addressing some issues that are already considered closed regulatory-wise, is that vision's got to be pretty clear to us, is that you want an industrial park, and we would like an industrial cleanup. We have commonality, but at the same time is that you could turn right around and say, how in the world can we have an industrial park if we don't have a water line? And I think that makes sense to everybody sitting in here tonight.
Or if there's already existing disposal cell in the middle of that process.
So that recommendation in my mind would be critical if it says the right things. Not the location of the line, but as a concept, I think, at least, I've been messing with this site for 17 years, and it's pretty important that we understand is that this is the most comprehensive look I've seen in a real redevelopment plan. So I think, these guys made a lot of assumptions, and I told them a week ago when we talked about the presentation that you might get kicked a little bit, but the point is that you're talking about details and assumptions, and those may not be 100% accurate. But at the end of the day, are we hearing the right thing? Is this an industrial park? And if so, your recommendation can endorse an industrial park that has specifically called out some of the requirements you have for an industrial park, or the whole concept of coming up to industrial standards doesn't make sense from your perspective.
I mean, it's a good data point. I think it's obviously an option or a scenario to consider. So I appreciate the information, and I agree, it's more
next level of a view, which may or may not be the ultimate vision of the end state, but certainly a good example of another view or an option.
It's not casting stone either.
Sir, I just think it's important that as we go forward with the proposed plan, we get all these, even though this is skeletal, whatever you're going, whatever you want to put on the skeleton. But I think it would behoove this body to make sure, and as we come together and make recommendations, that we make sure that the recommendations that we go forward are in the proposed plan, that go forth to DOE and to the regulators and to everyone, so there's a document that states exactly what's going to happen, so that when we're gone or not here, whatever, that someone can go back and say, these are the wishes, these are what the parties that are involved, engaged in, and decided on. So it's extremely important that our recommendations going forward, in my way of thinking, are very skeletal in nature. Like Greg said, you don't need to necessarily say where the water line needs to go or not go, but the specifics of what we want to see happen are in that proposed plan. And I have one more question. I'd like to ask Dennis Carr. Dennis, the things that were proposed tonight, are these within the realm of what you feel like Bloor is doing with your contract with DOE? Are these things that you've been engaged in?
Yes. I mean, our contract is DOE to site and to complete the environmental restoration of the site. We have to start with an end in mind. We need to know exactly what configuration needs to be at the end, what grade plan, what sewer stays, what telephone pole stays, what fire hydrant stays when it comes down. So as we progress, there's going to be 1,000 design packages put issue. We're already doing. We're already out redesigning. We're already doing. So we're proceeding down the path today. All right. So we need to have an end state vision in mind so we know exactly what needs to be left behind and what configuration. Heard before. Do we rip out the line? Do we leave the line? Do I leave the swale? Don't I have the swale? What's the grade plan for the area when we're done? We want to complete an area when you want to leave. You want to walk away with it done as opposed to going back to it. So the whole point here is to come to a consensus around a vision so that you have a vision so that you know how to factor into each individual design plan. Lay the concept out to the engineers so that each one of them knows where we're going, so that they know how to help. So when they do their individual small design package, that they know what they're going to leave behind at the end state goal. So that's where we're at. And I do believe that, you know, that everything here, it's not going to be an easy sell. I'm not going to say it's an easy sell. You know, there is incremental dollars. You're ripping up a landfill that's perfectly good. You know, I've ripped up quite a bit of landfills in the last 30 years, all right? And it's not fun work. Sitting in doubles and sucking down, you know, supplied air. It's not fun work. It's going to be expensive. It's going to be costly. And it is not going to be an easy sell. But at the same time, I do believe that there is cost trade-offs. There are trade-offs that can be shown that can create a compelling business case that might be the best thing to do. And if there's consensus of the community behind that same vision, I think it's just, you know, further emphasis, you have a compelling business case and you have a community that supports it, then you can achieve it. But in the end, what we're looking for, and number one, it is achievable, it is within the scope of our contract, but at the same time, you know, we've got to have an end state vision, and that's where we're at. And so we need to start with the end in mind. That's kind of where I'm at.
And I assume that was a yes.
Our scope.
Just one last thing I just pitch out there. I think it's important for all of us to have some cohesive vision of where we want to go, that we can all represent, and I'll say all of us, upstairs. And we need something to push funding this way. And I'm not allowed to talk about that much, but I just pitch that out there. I think it's important to all of us around the table that we all, whatever the vision is, that I think we need to come around that. And once we do, don't look back. That's what I just offer that.
One thing, this is my first thought process, my first thought was
people have listened, because there's been a lot of discussion. I'm not saying this is the end process, but at least it's taken a lot of those discussions. Remember the 12 points of enlightenment about, you know, no one's saying we're endorsing any kind of sale or not, but if there's going to be planning, you've got to plan with these 12 things, and some of those elements are in here, the consolidation, is it full or is it not, or is it the right ones, or, you know, only online ones or whatever, but some of those elements, I see this in each of those projects. Not the first thing I saw, I said, well, sounds like someone's heard some of the things that have said, whether it's the right end, that's a different issue, but it's just, the elements are plugged in here, the pieces of the puzzle, whether in the right places or on or off site, all that stuff has to be decided. I do think it's very beneficial for planning purposes, and limited by limited economic development background, obviously you have to have something like this to be able to market it and to receive funding and to get support, and then ultimately to market to an individual or a set of organizations to come here. You don't have that, you know, the field of dreams. You have to build it, in this case, put the infrastructure in before they come. And that is a key component to success. So it does have some elements that are obviously interesting.
Any other comments, questions from the board?
I just like to say that I agree we need to have a cohesive plan, but no question about that. I just have an issue with the waste disposal.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yes.
I just think it's good there that you're actually coming now and saying, you know, we went through a lot of process here and we're tearing this plant down, and now there's somebody working to a vision of what we can actually have and actually get to. You know, it's a step to me. This is still a step forward. May not be quite agreed on yet, but it's a step forward with a vision. I think people now have a better view of, I know I have, of what possibly could happen by using the construction end or the deconstruction of it to actually make something here, that there will be something here for the future. That's just what I see that.
Frank?
Yeah, I think you go up north and look at what used to be Rickenbacker Air Force Base. It's a large industrial site now, and we can have the same thing here. Don't have my manager.
Good observation.
Okay, we are 2 hours in at this point. How's everyone doing?
We're good.
We keep rolling?
Yeah, awesome.
All right, the next item on the list, the administrative issues. I don't know if anything we need to take action on. Is there anything that I'm not aware of?
I want to suck up.
I'll make a motion for that. Give me a second. Then we'll suck up. All right, subcommittee updates. Under tab 6, we have the cleanup and land use.
Yeah, we had a really good meeting. We had a presentation by the Kenneth and Associates on actual redevelopment commitment plan. And when I first started listening to them, I wasn't very, optimistic, thank you. That's the word I was looking at, because I had dealt with some of the economic development people in regions down here, and I knew it was going to be a tough sell to get everybody together and working on the same page. So I decided that I would go to the Ross County Chamber meeting and listen to this again. And I will say the one thing I picked up that just clicked, and I don't think people are really understanding this 700 acres that we have, when the gentleman said, you just don't have that anymore. You don't have a farm you can go to anymore instead of like to buy 500, 1,000 acres. They're gone, they're redeveloped. You know, you might find maybe 1,000 acres in Texas, but that doesn't have water rights, and that doesn't have so many things involved. We are setting, and I just opened my eyes and thought, yeah, there's some hope for us in the future that we are sitting in a great place if we do this right. And like somebody else had mentioned to me, we have one chance to do this right for our community and bring jobs in here. Because we've traveled different places across the country, when something's closed, Congress is not going to come back and say, well, you know, maybe you could make a better decision and let's do this now. When it's done, it's over, it's closed, we have one chance. So, like I said, sitting through the second meeting, I picked up a lot of good points, so, you know, I think it's a really good thing that they're in our corner. Following that, our next meeting will be Tuesday, next Tuesday, April 10th at 6:30.
Same. Any other questions or comments for acceptance?
Yeah, the gentleman that came, you know, they talked about the regional economic strategy. I mean, that was a regional strategy, not just a strategy for what's going on here. And I was actually very disappointed that they basically totally ignored and blew off one of the biggest growing region areas of economics in the area, and that's tourism. They basically totally discounted it. I mean, I understand it doesn't bring in super high paying jobs, but all we have to do is look over to one of our neighboring counties, Adams County, and it is one of the biggest income makers in Adams County at this particular time, bigger than the industries. And I just think I was very disappointed the fact that they don't have any kind of strategy at all for bringing people in. Tourism, just anything can be bring people in. The more people we have coming in, I think the better off our county is going to be. I mean, it's a trickle down type of thing.
Anything else from that committee? Thank you, Bob. Tab 7, waste disposition and recycling. Will.
We started off our meeting with a brief from Mark Jewett, and he covered an accident that had taken place at another site. And he discussed how that could potentially occur with the road traffic and things as we move forward with the process. It was just an accident. There wasn't any way that it could have been avoided by any of the staff. So, it's just something for us to think about as we move forward with the process. There was a mother and a child that were killed just by moving the material from one location to the other location. So, there are people involved in whatever we do. So, then we had a brief by J.D. Chu, who talked about the waste acceptance and what was involved with that process. It was a good brief. Covered a lot of information. He was available to answer questions. I think we kind of gave him a run for his money, maybe earned his paycheck. So, Dennis Carr gave us a nice brief over the landfills that are on site, as well as the closures. What was that, Dan?
Everything you ever want to know.
Yeah, that's right. So appreciated that presentation as well. It was obviously very knowledgeable about what we have on site, and was able to answer quite a few questions as well. So that's pretty much what we covered during the course of our meeting. We came up with a plan of action. We're still working on a recommendation regarding recycling and looking at requesting that DOE bring in some agencies that are pushing the envelope as far as recycling opportunities. So that's pretty much what we've covered. Any questions from anyone?
Thanks, Tab 8 has a summary of the executive committee. Is there anything you'd like to?
We did discuss the our top two issues that we'll be taking to Paducah for the chairs meeting in the middle of this month. And I believe they're being formulated. And basically the issues that we decided on were budget and reindustrialization, future site, what's this site going to look like. Let's see, we also had Nickel Expression of Interest, which Floor has put out to the for Expression of Interest. And we look at that as very, very interesting. And
Bill Barnes, of course, said it'd be very interesting, especially if Ohio Edison plays a part in it, which it would be. The SSAB habitat tour, which was conducted last month, I believe a tour of the woodlands of the site was made, and that was very interesting for the ones that went along on that tour. They showed the attendees how to bore a tree to indicate how old it is. Everyone indicated that it was a very good tour, although we only had two people from the board attend this meeting, Brian, and I forget who else, Sharon?
Mark.
Mark, yeah. The next item was elections for leadership for 2012-2013. And I suggested that we would have this time a slate of candidates come forward, or board members come forward to express an interest if they wanted to run for the office of chair or vice chair for that matter. I indicated myself that at the end of this fiscal year, which is the end of September, that I would be stepping down as the chair. So we need somebody to step forward and run for that position. I've been with this position ever since the beginning. That's about 3 years. And 4 years, I'm sorry. And I think it's time for somebody else to step up to the plate and handle the duties of chair. So we discussed that, and the fact that I'll mention it tonight, give you some time to think about it, all of you, and we'll go from there. And I think that was about it. Oh, Eric Roberts indicated that the John Joseph will be at in Paducah. How many people are going to Paducah? I am. Are you planning on going? And Christy. And Will, you're not going?
No, I'll be on the
Okay. Okay, that was about it on the executive meeting. There are a few action items on it that Rick Green's going to develop some talking points on the top two issues and one accomplishment. And one very important thing, mentoring our, I think it's five or six new members. We anticipate coming to join us in June. So we need somehow to mentor them, to train them, to welcome them, and so forth. Give them some of the ideas that we had to go through from the very beginning. So it's a learning process, a site tour, and so forth. That's it.
Yes.
Dick, if I may, you touched on the mentoring there right at the end, and I think it's going to be extremely important that we go ahead and make it more of a formalized arrangement where an individual who is currently serving on the board is specifically assigned the responsibility of the mentorship.
You did mention that, yes. Mm-hmm. And what he's saying is that some of you will become mentors to these new members, which I think is a very good idea.
Mm-hmm. So as we move forward...
As well as a primer on what goes on here, that's being developed.
So as we move forward, we'll be looking for volunteers that are on the board to step forward and take over that role of mentor.
I know the executive committee has looked at that several times, and that you've asked us to put together a draft protocol on how to handle that. You can just give me 2 weeks, the chair's meeting. We will take over that with full steam at that point.
Thanks, sir.
We have full intention to be completely ready by June.
And
also, at the chair meeting, just so you guys know, there's going to be a special recognition for Dick for his time as chair at the headquarters. If you look across the complex, after about 18 months, somebody serving as chair on the board kind of hits the wall.
Suicide.
Yeah. At about the 2-year mark, there's someone here, zombie kind of, and Dick's been with us for 4 years.
It's really outstanding.
I stay on the board, it's just not in service. I guess I'd like to stay, so.
Maybe you're one of the mentors.
Pretty outstanding, so. Sometime after he stepped down, we'll tell all the stories, we'll take him out traveling. All right, so we're going to slide over to public comments. And speaking of Dick, Mr. Chair?
Sure.
Oh, yes, Chair, sure.
I mentioned something really quick because it was at the end of our executive session, that you were going to be seeing the video when you're in Paducah. And I just want to bring it up that next Wednesday is the Pike County Chamber Luncheon. It's a monthly luncheon that we hold, and we will be showing the video at our luncheon.
It'll be here, right?
And it's open to the public, it's here at the Endeavor Center. So it's, if anyone is interested, the phone number at the chamber to make your reservation for a box lunch, if you can order one or you can come, you don't have to eat. But the number's 947-7715 for anybody that would like to call and make your reservation. We're just trying to get an idea of how many people so we can make sure we have the room size correct. So it's 11:30 to 12:30 next Wednesday at 11.
And we will definitely make that available. We are trying to negotiate with the Indian Movie Theater across the street from the complex that had it kind of a bigger thing. So we're trying to get that square right.